Hello, and welcome to our in-depth look at communications with precision data converters. In this video, we describe the timing requirements and switching characteristics between digital lines associated with serial peripheral interface or SPI communication. We'll discuss timing and switching specifications that you may see in a datasheet. Then we'll describe an example of the timing diagram for one of TI's precision data converters. In a previous video, we discussed how data is clocked into and out of precision data converters using the four digital lines of SPI, an active low peripheral select line, commonly known as chip select, is used to select the device for communication. A serial clock of S-clock clocks data in and out of the peripheral device to the controller. Finally, data lines of MOSI and MISO, commonly named DIN and DOUT for the peripheral device, are used to send the data. For all of these digital lines, there are specifications that define the time required from the change of one digital line to another. Many of these specifications are related to the time between the changes in the data of the DIN and DOUT lines to S-clock. These specifications ensure that the data is properly clocked into and out of the digital sections of the controller and peripheral device. Regardless, all timing specifications must be followed to ensure that the controller and peripheral device are properly sending and receiving data. Violating a timing specification can cause failure to read the data and may cause unexpected results. Most timing specifications can be categorized into one of three categories. There are setup times, hold times, or propagation delays. Using this timing diagram, we show the S-clock, DIN, and DOUT of a peripheral device. Using SPI mode 0, the S-clock idles low and the data is clocked in on the rising edge of the S-clock. First, setup time is the time required for a data input to be stable before the edge of the clocking signal to be latched correctly. In the diagram, the example is SPI mode 0, where S-clock idles low and the data is clocked in on the rising edge of S-clock. DIN is set high so that at a rising edge of S-clock, A1 is clocked into the peripheral device. DIN must be set high first, and it must stay high for a specific setup time so that the 1 is properly received. Second, hold time is the time required for a data input to be held at the proper level after the clocking signal. In the diagram, DIN is already set high, and then the S-clock rises to clock in the signal. DIN must stay high for a hold time after the clock rises to ensure that the 1 again is properly received. Lastly, there are propagation delays. This term describes the time required for the signal from one line to change the signal from another. In the diagram, the S-clock comes into the device and the controller reads DOUT on the rising edge of the clock. For the peripheral device, the falling edge of the clock sets up the next data bit so that by the rising edge of the clock when the controller reads the device, the correct data is on DOUT. This delay time describes how long it takes from the S-clock falling edge to place the data on the DOUT line. Here, we take an in-depth look at SPI timing from an example datasheet. Using the ADS1118 Precision ADC, two tables show the timing requirements and the switching characteristics. Typically, timing requirements show setup and hold times for the SPI communications, and the switching characteristics will show propagation delays. These tables will give minimum and maximum times for different characteristics shown in a timing diagram. Continuing with the example, here is the timing diagram. We can go through the specifications and explain how to read them. The timing diagram shows specific timing requirements between the different digital lines. For all digital communications, this timing must be followed or the device may not recognize commands, fail to understand the configuration settings, or properly output data. We'll cover each of these specifications and explain what they mean. TCSH is the hold time of chip select. This is the minimum amount of time that chip select can be held high that ensures that the device recognizes that the chip select has been set high and low again. Here, it does not appear to be a hold time because it does not come before a clock signal in the diagram. However, this timing is internal and defines a hold time based on latching the CS signal to an internal clock. TCSSC is the minimum time required between chip select transitioning low and the first S clock. As chip select is taken low, it still takes a small amount of time for the device to determine that it is the active peripheral. This also allows for time to set up data that the device needs to send out on D out at the first S clock rising edge pulse. TS clock is the S clock period. S clock must have a minimum period to ensure proper digital timing. Transistors and logic gates can't be clocked infinitely fast, so there is a limit to how fast data can be clocked out. TSPWH and TSPWL are the minimum time periods for the S clock pulse high and low. This is similar to the total minimum S clock period, but it really describes the acceptable duty cycle and skew of the S clock signal. For this timing specification, there is an additional limit. The timing requirement table lists a maximum TSPWL time of 28 milliseconds. This maximum time comes from a timeout built into the SPI communications of this device. TSCCS is the minimum time from the last S-clock falling edge to the rising edge of chip select. This is a specification required for clocking in data to the device. Because chip select disables the SPI communication, any data must be clocked into the device with the falling edge of S-clock before chip select rises. It is a hold time for the data with S-clock and a setup time for the chip select to the device's internal clock. TSCSC is the time required between the last falling edge of S-clock from one command to the next rising edge of S-clock for the next command. For the device, there is some time required to parse and execute a command in one chip select frame before being able to take another command from another chip select frame. TDIST is the setup time for the DIN data. In this diagram, the communication uses SPI mode 1, where the S clock idles low and data are clocked in on the falling edge of S clock. Here, the DIN is typically set up on the rising edge of S clock, but this defines a minimum time that DIN must be valid before the falling edge of S clock. Again, this device is SPI mode 1, where the data is clocked in at the falling edge of S clock. The setup time is the time required for DIN to be stable before the active falling S clock edge. TDIHD is the hold time for the DIN data. When the data is clocked in on the falling edge of S clock, DIN must be stable from the setup time before and the hold time after the S clock falling edge. TCSDOD is the time from the falling edge of chip select to the enabling of D out. When chip select is high, the D out of the peripheral device is high impedance or high Z. This prevents an inactive peripheral device from trying to drive the D out line. When chip select is driven low, D out is driven by the active peripheral. TCSDOD shows the propagation delay from the chip select going low to when D out is active. TDOPD is the maximum propagation delay time from the rising edge of S clock to the data appearing on D out. Again, data is clocked out by the controller on the falling edge of S clock, so the rising edge of S clock is used by the device to send data to D out. TDOHD is the propagation delay time from the S clock rising edge to when D out becomes invalid. Again, D out is set up on the rising edge of S clock so that it can be read out on the falling edge of S clock. However, if you choose to read the data, you have until TDOHD after the next rising edge of S clock to read the data. This specification isn't important if the data is read on the falling edge of S clock. TCSDOZ is the time from the rising edge of chip select to when D out returns to high impedance. Similar to TCSDOD, this is important when there are multiple peripheral devices on the SPI bus. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content. Question 1. The following diagram is C polarity equal to 0 and C phase equal to 1. Data is clocked in on the falling edge of S clock. Dn must be stable for a time after the S clock falling edge. This timing is an example of which timing requirement? The correct answer is B, hold time. Question 2. The following diagram is C polarity equal to 0 and C phase equal to 1. Dn and dout are red on the falling edge of S clock. However, dout is set up on the rising edge of S clock, and there may be time required for the data to arrive on dout. This timing is an example of which timing requirement? The correct answer is C, propagation delay. Question 3. The following diagram is C polarity equal to 0 and C phase equal to 1. Data is clocked in on the falling edge of S clock. Dn must be stable for a time before the falling edge of S clock. This timing is an example of which timing requirement? The correct answer is A, setup time.